not able to join us today can view it later. At our last spotlight event in January 2020, we adopted climate action as a focus for the year. During the year, we organized several dozen climate-related events, and 9 climate initiatives emerged, led by students, faculty, and staff. Thanks to President Barron, the university joined the International Universities Climate Alliance and signed a letter encouraging the leaders of G20 nations to take bold climate action. Other initiatives included making Penn State carbon negative. The Faculty Senate passed a climate resolution and prepared an advisory report for the president. Students had a petition drive with over 2,000 signatures. The climate crossover curriculum initiative impacted several hundred students, and OPP continued its reduction of our carbon footprint with operationalizing of the 70 megawatt solar panels. And this is only a partial list. Our second major focus for last year was institutionalizing sustainability across Penn State. We encouraged deans and chancellors to establish a sustainability council, create a sustainability charter, and appoint a sustainability chair in their respective unit. 12 colleges and 7 campuses took leadership in creating these structures, in addition to other units, but we are highlighting the colleges and campuses today. Additionally, the F&B division already had a sustainable operations council since 2017. Today, we celebrate these leaders and have invited them to highlight how sustainability and climate action are being incorporated in their unit's strategic plan. We will go through 20 quick presentations of 2 minutes each. I know this is challenging, but I also know that it can be done because all of you are sustainability stars. And remember, 2 minutes is more than double the time of an average speech at the Academy Awards, Oscars Awards. So you have more time than you would normally get in your other profession. Before starting the presentations, I want to welcome President Dr. Eric Barron and invite him to say a few words on his vision for sustainability at Penn State. He needs no introduction to this internal audience, but I do want to acknowledge that in addition to his skills in sustainably leading our large and complex institution through crisis times, he is an accomplished scientist with a background in atmospheric and oceanic sciences. He has served on many national committees and federal agencies, including the National Research Council, to tackle fundamental challenges of sustainability, economic development, and energy security. I now invite President Barron to make his remarks.
Well, thank you, Paul, and good afternoon, and Happy New Year to everyone. You know, I recently saw a cartoon of a woman jumping out of a burning building labeled 2020. And she landed on taut fabric held by firefighters, and because the fabric was taut, bounced right up into the window of a building labeled 2021, which was also burning. And that does seem to about sum it up in terms, at least the way I feel as we've passed that new year mark. Well, things like a sustainability spotlight are a reminder that much will change for the better, I think, because Penn State can impact the world through sustainability, through our teaching, research, and service. If I think about climate change as a focus, which I know a bit more about, and energy, it's been an interesting year. Fires in California, a remarkable number of hurricanes and other significant extreme weather events, numerous scientific reports discussing climate change, a couple of oddballs that just got released recently without the authorization of the president's science advisor. But that aside, it's been a significant year, and Penn State's research has contributed significantly to many of those climate challenges and to what it means for our planet. The reality is that it's going to take a broad involvement across all colleges, campuses, schools. It's remarkable in my mind how many disciplines are connected in one way or another to climate and to energy. It's going to take connections to industry, and it's going to take a great deal for us to transition to renewable energy sources that minimize greenhouse gas emissions. Penn State's working hard. We're recognized as a leader in energy. In fact, Penn State ranks in the top 10 in United States in 12 different research areas that range from biofuels to batteries to energy policy to economics and law. Throughout the university, an astounding 460 individual investigators are contributing to energy research. Plus, there's nearly 100 different opportunities in education and courses to explore energy as part of an education. Some of them begin in K through 12. In addition, Penn State has to and must walk the walk while we're doing this research and education. So in that regard, we've cut our energy emissions by 32% since 2005. There's been a goal set by the state of Pennsylvania to cut energy emissions by reducing emissions by 80% from 2005 to 2050. I'm convinced we can do a lot better than that, certainly faster than that. There are a wide range of strategies. I was very proud last year to deploy a shovel in partnership with Lightsource BP on three solar farms that will supply 25% of Penn State statewide electricity needs and will dramatically lower what our greenhouse gas emissions are like. And these sites provide a remarkable opportunity for students, faculty, and professionals to conduct various types of research. Another example, Penn State, as was mentioned, was just one of 37 universities around the world to join the International Universities Climate Alliance. The whole purpose of this is to urge the G20 world leaders to protect humankind from climate change. Penn State is also working to contribute to climate change understanding and solutions through excellence in energy, policy, law, and other disciplines such as communications. We need to advance effective sustainability communications. It's remarkable to me that in this field, it's either X or Y, and the whole breadth of knowledge that we have about sustainability is not well communicated to the public. It's a critical piece in our persuasion and in making sure that we motivate citizens to action. Now, in this regard, Michael Mann has been a vocal force, and he's won the Schneider Award for Outstanding Science Communication, as well as the 2020 World Sustainability Award. Interestingly, if you go look at the Schneider Awards, it's a relatively recent award, and two Penn Staters have received this award, Rick Alley being another one. And great deal of pleasure for me personally, because I had something to do with hiring Rick, and also as dean when Michael Mann came aboard in the College of Earth and Mineral Sciences. But a great deal of pleasure for me because Stephen Schneider, I did my postdoc with him at the National Center for Atmospheric Research, and the two of us had the pleasure of writing a number of fun papers together. Well, as you'll hear today, this is only the beginning. Penn State has much more to offer, both on the research, energy transition, renewable energy, and curricular innovation. Our students will live in a climate-altered world, and we must prepare them for that world through the research that we do, through the education that we provide, and through our commitment to service to the citizens of the Commonwealth of the United States and increasingly the world. I'm very pleased that we're beginning this year, 2021, by focusing on what our sustainability councils in each unit are doing. It's exciting for me. It may be one Academy Award presentation after another, but it's a wonderful opportunity to see what's happening at Penn State and what's planned. I really wish to thank Paul for his leadership of the Sustainability Institute, as well as the many faculty, students, and staff who've contributed to its success. This afternoon, we will hear about a wide range of initiatives calling for the incorporation of sustainability, including diversity, equity, inclusion, and climate action. We will also hear how to plan for curricular, co-curricular, staff and student engagement, teaching and research, outreach and operations across this rich Commonwealth system. I hope today's spotlight inspires you to continue your good work and to reach out to others in the group to create new projects that will impact the world. I look forward to seeing what you're doing, and I truly appreciate being here and joining you and having you join us today. Thank you.
Thank you, President Barron. And I'm going to hand it to Diana to bring out the stars. That's the order of presentation?
This is the order of presentations. Each unit will have 2 minutes to present, and they know what they're calling their marching orders are.
Thanks to the Sustainability Institute for organizing this event. I am Mihan Kang, Director for Sustainability in the College of Arts and Architecture. Dean Carpenter is with us today. Thanks, Dean Carpenter, for leading our colleagues to foster arts design and sustainability. The College of Arts and Architecture strategically advanced sustainability, integrating it into the college's strategic plan. We had a sustainability strategic planning retreat with 32 faculty and staff representing colleges, academic outlets, and supporting areas. Diverse voices were inclusively molded in the college-wide survey to gather more feedback. As a result, with further efforts, the latest college strategic plan draft addresses sustainability. For example, ensuring that our initiatives highlight the significance of the UN Sustainable Development Goals and further our understanding and commitment to equity and social relevance to advance innovative practices. The Sustainability Council's significant milestone is the working group's development to institutionalize sustainability. Each working group's teaching and learning, research, outreach, and operation sets goals and initiatives which support the strategic plan. For example, Sustainability Symposium was held, and I am sharing the video link in the chat for you to look at later. Our research centers and initiatives make sustainability efforts, such as climate, social justice, and historic and cultural preservation. For example, the Studio for Sustainability and Social Action is dedicated to the sustainability through artistic practices and will host an inaugural symposium and exhibition in April. Let me also share the link for the upcoming event. Thank you so much.
Hello, everyone. Thanks very much for the opportunity to be a part of this. I'm Julia Pinto from the Department of Journalism and the Science Communication Program in the Belisario College of Communications, led by Dean Marie Hardin. At the Belisario College, we work to prepare the next generation of journalists, digital storytellers, strategic communicators, and scholars for leadership in their professions and society, and particularly by advancing knowledge that addresses the grand challenges of our time, such as the paths forward to creating a just and sustainable future. This year, our inaugural Sustainability Council is beginning the process of drafting our charter, and we are excited to leverage the great resources, talent, and initiatives already in place. Some examples include our science communication program, which involves scholars across departments who study the intersections of health, environment, science, media, and society, and who have proven records in interdisciplinary collaborations. We have a number of graduate students who are now working in these areas, and we are pleased to see continued and growing interest from our applicants. Our popular SciComm Lab is a space where students and faculty come together to pitch research ideas, gain feedback, and develop collaborations across academic units, and our speaker series has resonated with the community. To bring research into our classrooms, we are developing standalone courses as well as infusing existing ones around sustainability and related issues. Our new media center, which will include a newsroom, news lab, and audio and television production facilities, also represents a powerful opportunity to serve the Commonwealth and bring multimedia content about sustainability into our communities. Finally, the college's new Sustainability Council represents faculty across departments and those working in diversity, equity, inclusion, innovation, and entrepreneurship. In particular, we seek to ensure that students are culturally proficient communicators who have the knowledge base to engage others around sustainability and meaningfully impact communities around the world. Thank you very much.
Next slide, please. The College of Earth and Mineral Sciences has a long history in environmental sustainability, including five faculty whose work with the IPCC contributed to winning a Nobel Peace Prize in 2007, and winners of the 2019 Tyler Prize for Environmental Achievement, also known as the Nobel for the Environment. Our most recent efforts began in 2018 and resulted in the appointment of a sustainability officer and the creation of five committees comprised of 27 volunteers and 12 members from our alumni board. Our major accomplishments in 2020 include the completion of a 12-page sustainability action plan with 12 goals and 54 actions, a greenhouse gas emissions inventory based on fiscal year 2018-19, and a related how-to guide for college or unit-level emissions inventories. We've concluded from our emissions inventory that we must reduce those emissions directly in our control, but we'll also strongly advocate for and support university level purchases of renewable power and increased efficiencies to reduce emissions from our steam plants. Moving into 2021, we will accomplish building energy audits and energy use displays to spur efficiencies and reductions, a student survey to determine how they view sustainability aspects of our curriculum, increased outreach efforts focusing on our web presence, and a behavioral assessment survey to determine what drives our community to lead sustainable lives or not, to guide how we might approach behavioral change. Finally, we've inaugurated an annual competition to an EMS sustainability from, and from that are tentatively planning to begin building a college solar array, purchase some third-party carbon offsets, and fund research aimed at all the stuff listed in the bottom right corner of the slide. Thanks for your time.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Charles Anderson, the Sustainability Council Chair for the Eberly College of Science, and I'm pleased to be joined today by Dean Tracy Langkild. In the Eberly College of Science, we ask fundamental questions and conceive practical solutions for sustainability. We do this largely by working together, participating in and leading centers of research excellence that address many of the UN Sustainable Development Goals, or SDGs. For example, we promote good health and well-being by studying how human-wildlife interactions lead to outbreaks of new diseases in the Center for Infectious Disease Dynamics. We also seek to empower affordable and clean energy in the context of climate action through the Center for Lignocellulose Structure and Formation, studying how plants convert sunlight, water, and air into renewable energy and materials. Finally, we help protect life below water by connecting science to policy. Our Center for Marine Science and Technology not only develops strategies for restoring coral reefs damaged by climate change, as shown on the lower left, but also participates in the Consortium for Ocean Leadership to help translate the goals of the UN Decade of Ocean Science for Sustainable Development, which started 12 days ago, into federal legislation that supports the health of our oceans and the people who depend on them. Our Sustainability Council is working together to advance sustainability goals across the college. Dean Langkild recently approved our college's first sustainability charter, and our college will hold a sustainability town hall in March to catalyze new ideas and actions to more fully incorporate UN SDGs into our college's teaching, research, outreach, and service activities. We are hosting a Frontiers of Science series on how science can help achieve the UN SDGs and are measuring our college's carbon footprint as a preamble to more rapidly reducing our greenhouse gas pollution. Finally, one of our college's student leaders, Kara Fleigel, is leading the development of a new sustainability major at Penn State. We look forward to continuing to work together this year toward a brighter and more sustainable future for everyone. Thank you.
All right, next slide, please. So the College of Engineering has an overarching philosophy that guides our decision-making as we prioritize our activities. So in the sustainability space, our mantra is implementation of immediately actionable solutions to local sustainability challenges with global impact. And this is the lens through which we assess our ideas and outcomes. Some specific details and updates. We have continued to build on last year's accomplishments, including aligning courses and active research projects with the UN SDGs across all 13 of our departments. This has included a targeted analysis of our strengths and weaknesses, as well as recommendations for a holistic approach going forward, emphasizing opportunities to enhance equity and inclusion across the college. We have also continued to offer the nation's first research experiences for undergraduate site, focused specifically on drawdown strategies to reverse global warming. We offer this RU both on-site and now in remote programming, demonstrating the resilience of the program and the transferability to other institutions around the world. Our lasting commitment to drawdown is also reflected in piloting it as a motivational unifying theme in the College of Engineering's first year seminars, which is a core element of our first year curriculum, and in our study abroad courses. In addition, we have developed a co-curricular micro-credential badging system to enable our undergraduate students to develop a tailored plan to be recognized for their accomplishments in sustainability, both inside and outside of traditional classroom settings, and ultimately earn a certification by the National Academy of Engineering. In the coming year, we are finalizing our 2021 to 25 strategic plan, in which we've infused sustainability into all of our goals. And we are currently working on a number of transformational initiatives in which to include sustainability will be infused. Thus, we're infusing our efforts with these cornerstones of equity and sustainability, including the development of our equity action plan, our completely revamped first and second year engineering education programs, and our push to grow research and graduate programs. We're also continuing the drawdown RAU site program with expanded partnerships across the university. And plans are underway to launch a new Center for Climate Solutions with a unique emphasis on industry engagement to make lasting reductions to greenhouse gases and improve our climate in real time. Thank you. And thank you to Rachel Brennan for all she has done to lead these efforts.
Good afternoon, everyone. Next slide, please. Thank you. I'm Amit Sharma, and Dean New Schaefer is also with us today from the College of Health and Human Development. The College of Health and Human Development Sustainability Council was appointed earlier last year. Since then, we've been working on several initiatives and thinking through approaches to strengthen sustainability and engagement, engagement in sustainability throughout the college, and we're going to share a few of those with you today. The council has been working on creating a charter for the college. Broadly speaking, the charter will highlight our vision for sustainability in the areas of teaching, research, operations, and outreach. It also emphasizes the importance of strengthening our ongoing activities, such as a sustainability leadership minor that's housed in the college, and also developing new initiatives that will integrate sustainability throughout the college. One of our first activities of the council was to complete a baseline inventory of current interests and activities in teaching and research associated with the sustainable development goals. We were very encouraged by the level of participation by the faculty in this exercise, as we believe that it demonstrates our eagerness and interest in sustainability across the college. The sustainable development goals that appear are more frequently across the college units are shown on the slide. However, this is by no means the exhaustive list. In the fall semester, the council also worked closely with Dean New Schaefer to incorporate sustainability in the college's strategic plan. Besides the immediate goal, this process was also helpful for the council to think more strategically, both in the short and the long term. For instance, we're exploring activities that will include all stakeholders, students, staff, faculty. Some of these will be grassroots level, such as smaller group activities in the units, and others will be across the college. So in summary, we are looking forward to finalizing the charter and then begin systematically refer to a strategic plan and the information from the baseline engagement to launch new initiatives this year. Thank you.
Thank you.
This is Janet Swim, and I'm here being supported with Dean Bennett. And what we've done in the College of Liberal Arts is we basically rebooted our sustainability group. And with that, we spent some time developing our charter, and which developed our vision and mission and some of our principles and goals. And within that, we carry those out by our four subcommittees. We have an advisory committee composed of seven people, three of which are representatives from our subcommittees of education, research, and operations, which have 4 to 5 people on each of those committees. What we spent a fair amount of time doing initially was to have a proposed addition of sustainability to the College of Liberal Arts strategic plan, and I understand that's being under consideration. We've been ongoing review of activities in the College of Liberal Arts to see who's doing what, and also comparing them with other universities to see what they've been doing. We're in the process of creating a website with some things that we hope follows one of our principles of empowering people to be able to do things. And so we have established, now we're in the process of establishing an expert database, which will provide information about both research and teaching amongst our faculty. We also will have various resources for students, faculty, and staff, and these will be classes that they could take if they wanted to add more sustainability into their coursework, funding opportunities that become available, events on campus and off of campus, and various announcements within that. We hope that our expert database will be a resource for both people on campus and outside of campus to form collaborations. In the next 6 to 12 months, we're going to continue some of our other activities, which had been part of Clearwater Cleanup. We're going to be developing some monthly sustainability discussions that we hope will facilitate both funding and course development. And that's it.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you to Paul and everyone at the Sustainability Institute for organizing this event. We're relatively new additions to this community, but are really excited to be here. I'm Nathan Pekelik, co-chair of the University Library's Sustainability Council, along with my colleague and co-chair, Ben Goldman. And we're really grateful to our sponsoring administrator who joins us today.
Hello, everyone. I'm Miho Gozoi, the Associate Dean for Library Collections, Research, and Scholarly Communications. I serve as the sponsor for the Library's Sustainability Council.
The University Library Sustainability Council was charged March 13th, 2020, the Friday after many of us were sent home from campus as a result of the ongoing pandemic. In October, we delivered an introductory presentation at our college's Dean's Forum and surveyed our colleagues about the relationship between the UN SDGs and our current work, as well as what sustainability efforts we should focus on in the near future. Based on the 110 responses that we received, we will prioritize work around the sustainable development goals that relate to quality education, SDG 4, gender equality, SDG 5, healthy lives, SDG 3, economic growth, SDG 8, and justice for all, SDG 16.
One way for us to enhance the quality of education is to promote open access to scholarly journals. I am pleased to announce that the University Libraries and Cambridge University Press recently agreed with a 3-year open access read and publish e-journal agreement. This agreement will promote sustainability of our library's collections while increasing visibility of Penn State research. With this new agreement, Penn State corresponding authors' articles will become immediately open access on the publisher's platform. The important next steps include developing initiatives around the 5 aforementioned sustainable development goals and integrating them into the University Library's strategic plan. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Sarah Bronson from the College of Medicine, Hershey Medical Center Sustainability Council. I'm joined today by Dean Black from the College of Medicine and a handful of members from the council. Thanks for showing up, team. So we are acutely aware of this relationship between climate change and the health system. So climate change causes our patients to come to us at times. It interferes with our ability to deliver care at times. But the health system also has an impact on the environment in terms of greenhouse gas emissions and waste. There's three teams that we have on the council, environment, health, and equity. And I've chosen just to highlight a few of the things that have happened this last year, despite the fact of our distraction with COVID, which is understandable. So in environment, our facilities team, which has been one of the real rock stars on the environment team, has went from 3 stars to 4 stars in the Professional Ground Management Society savings due to our energy savings program. We had the environmental health and medicine student group initiated long-term weatherproof recycling signage for student housing. We have a couple of members on the council that are on the Derry Township Climate Action Change Committee. And so we've been having conversations with them and helping to understand what our contribution is on the campus to the local greenhouse gas emissions. Our Green Pause team in medical education documented that the shift to remote during COVID, you know, like over 35,000 sheets of paper are not being used anymore, and they have no plans to go back. We have a Penn Plus Penn marker recycling program. We had to pivot and find a new vendor, but we sent off our first 40-pound box, and that's led by the environment team as well. With the health category, we've reinvigorated our Hershey bike share with a new vendor, so we're excited about that. Our exercise and medicine was the featured sort of group at the Dean's lecture this fall and has had a lot of momentum in terms of bringing in research funding in that area. Beacon Clinic is an example of they have a prescription produce there, and one of our student interest groups in food as medicine during after the COVID situation became a crisis, opened up a healthy food pantry in Harrisburg. And one of our medical students, Natasha Sood, who I've talked about before here, was kind of my partner in getting this all off the ground. She is part of Medical Students for Sustainable Future and did a paper on climate and health curricular reform in medical schools. Finally, with regard to equity, we have a new seminar series on race and ethnic disparities that has been really exciting and a very bright spot in the last 6 months. And we have a new office for cancer health equity in the Penn State Cancer Institute. Okay, for the next 15 seconds, we're gonna do some sustainable health here. Stand up, take a stretch, pet the dog, scratch the cat, take a drink of water, anything that sort of gives you a little bit of a breather here in the middle.
Hello, my name is
Doreen. Thank you, Sarah, for the health check.
My turn. My name is Darlene Clark. I'm from the College of Nursing. I'd like to acknowledge Dean Lori Badzik, who's with us today, and acknowledge her strong support of our sustainability initiatives in the College of Nursing. I chose 3 highlights: teaching, research, and international collaboration. We just received approval for one of the courses, and we'll be offering another one in the fall as a result of a Reflection Project grant award. The first course is called Health and Environmental Sustainability, a 3-credit interdomain course offered through World Campus. It will begin next week and the course is full. The second 3-credit interdomain course is called Climate Change and Storytelling. Bill Doan and Aaron Kit Lewis are coordinating that course. We also developed guidelines and templates for how to integrate sustainability into our undergraduate core curriculum as it aligns with the UN SDGs, and we will implement that process in the fall. We initiated a sustainability review looking at the graduate curriculum and had the first meeting in December, so we'll move forward with that alignment as well in 2021. We had 1 refereed article and 1 conference presentation this past year. The authors on the refereed article were from the College of Nursing Sustainability Council faculty members, along with Peter Buck. And the virtual podium presentation focused on threading sustainability into our culture and curriculum and focusing on cultivating a generation of nurse leaders and sustainability. Lastly, and internationally, we are partnering with Monash University's School of Nursing and Midwifery to replicate their online survey, which assesses nursing faculty knowledge and efficacy of sustainable development goal incorporation into undergraduate nursing curriculum. And we are waiting now for IRB approval for Penn State at our end, and their survey is complete. These 3 bullets reflect and align with the College of Nursing strategic plan for sustainability. Thank you for your time.
So I'll kick things off here and then go to Eric. Paul, thank you to you and to the Sustainability Institute for arranging this meeting today. Sustainability continues to be a core element in our strategic plan and how we plan on advancing business education in SMEAL. Just one quick example, our Business Sustainability Strategy Graduate Certificate had 15 students last year and 107 students this year. Amazing progress yet again. Eric, take it away.
All right, thank you so much. Great to have you here with us, Chuck. Our Dean, Chuck Whiteman, has been a great supporter of sustainability from the beginning, even before I was even at SMEAL. So great to have you here, Chuck. Just want to acknowledge Dan Cahoy, who's our research director, is also here with us, and Suzanne Wright, who chairs our education and engagement working group, is also here. So we were asked to talk about major objectives for this year. We do have a number of them, but I'll just highlight three on the right-hand side of the slide here. We're having an industry roundtable bringing academics together with practitioners focused on ESG investing. The specific nature of that is to be determined, but you can be sure that it'll focus in part on how do we finance climate solutions and provide financing for things like minority and women-owned businesses. We will finish by Earth Day, we hope, the major sustainability website, which is a way that business students can see the connection between their major and how their major contributes to sustainability. Very excited about that. And then we'll be designed with campuses and for campuses. We'll be hosting the first undergraduate sustainability case competition. We work in the five areas on the left. I won't go through all those points there, but the work we do to support social enterprise, advanced impact research, educational programs at the undergraduate, graduate, and executive education level, student and alumni engagement, including our new SMEAL Sustainability Alumni Network, and our work with companies is something that will continue to expand in 2021. And I'm putting into the link, or into the chat, the link to the center if you'd like to learn more. Thanks.
Hello, I'm Lisa Emili from Penn State Altoona. Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak. I can't cover everything that we do as a result of our council. I am representing the Sustainability Council as well as our Chancellor and Dean Lori Bechtel-Wary today. We celebrated just this past fall our 10-year anniversary. And really, I want to focus on two of the key things that have allowed us to be successful these past 10 years. The first thing is that we've been able to integrate sustainability across our teaching, research, and service by linked activities. One example, we support local CSAs. A farm volunteered a site as a living laboratory for our students to study soil and water quality. The students present that data to the farmers. The farmers make best management practice decisions on that. And then we follow up and share the sustainability of the farm through our outreach and social media. We have been successful in institutionalizing sustainability at Penn State Altoona because of the structure of our council, which has been chartered also for 10 years. We have faculty, staff, students, community partners, but we also have our facilities and operations people who are key administrators and decision makers. So we have been able to put sustainability on the agenda from the outset, whether it's discussing new infrastructure, land management, other initiatives. Sustainability is part of our process. It's not just ad hoc projects. And finally, as we look forward and in our strategic planning, we really focus on our people as our most precious resource, our most valuable resource. And so a key component of our strategic plan going forward is the recruitment and retention of sustainability champions. Thank you very much for your time.
Hi, everyone. I'm Carrie McDougall, Director of Academic Affairs at Beaver. And as many of you know, Dr. Angela Fishman, Beaver's sustainability environmental guru, has retired to take on more global adventures. So I'm filling in as our campus's council chair. I decided to share with you all of our sustainability focused initiatives from our campus's new strategic plan, simply because I'm excited about how many there are and how they really commit our campus to an incredibly wide variety of UN SDGs. So don't even try to read them. I just wanted you to see the number of them. We decided this year, this is a huge jump for our campus. We decided this year that supporting diversity, equity, and inclusion initiatives needed to be in everything that we do as opposed to something we do on the side. So everything that we do has to support diversity, be equitable, and be inclusive. The other thing I wanted to point out is in the top group, a big project that focuses on the entrance acreage of our campus. That project will completely revamp a large number of acres on the so that the land has a focus on sustainability, green access, and academic use. Our campus land is incredibly beautiful. It used to be a farm, and we aren't engaging with the land as much as putting up with our tradition of grass and being a victim to the work that grass requires. So we are very much looking forward to making this huge cultural shift away from grass as we know it. And then last but not least, our campus farm continues to thrive. We just hired a new sustainable food systems education program coordinator, Taylor Whitehead, who hails from Chatham's sustainability program. And she also got her undergraduate in the ag program at Penn State. So I put a picture here of the farm's recent CSA. As the farm truly continues to be the center of our campus's sustainability efforts. But I'm happy to say that it's no longer in our strategic plan as it's so deeply in the weave of our campus and has the campus's full support. So while it's no longer a new initiative, it's just something that we do. It's in our campus blood and it's a given, which that is all due to Angela Fishman's work. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Sherry Mason. I go by Sam, and I'm the sustainability coordinator for Penn State Barron. Our chancellor, Ralph Ford, and associate dean, Ivor Knight, are both on this call as well. Over the summer, Barron was the first Commonwealth campus to submit a sustainability assessment known as STARS, having earned a bronze rating. Utilizing the data from this assessment, we're in the midst of creating a sustainability strategic plan for our campus, with three main goals being education and engagement, community and culture, and stewardship. This strategic plan has 12 objectives with 58 action steps, ranging from educating for sustainability to the increased presence of renewable energy sources to doing more to recognize and increase access for people of color. If you've ever been to Barron, you know that our campus sits on the escarpment above Lake Erie with an incredible gorge running alongside it. This past fall, with $690,000 of support from the DCED and the DCNR, along with campus beautification funds, we completed the first phase of a restoration plan for this space. It includes a parking lot, ADA accessible trail, boardwalks, rain gardens, and signage. We have obtained $380,000 DCNR grant to continue this work. Planning for phase two will commence this summer. Lastly, I wanted to feature our endeavors in establishing a sustainable food systems program at Barron. More attention than ever has been placed upon localizing and streamlining food systems because of the ongoing pandemic. Partnering with the Refugee Agricultural Partnership Program and the Erie County Department of Health, among others, and as a founding member of the Local Food Policy Advisory Council, we are poised to form a program which truly serves the community by creating a local resilient food system based on providing access to all, especially those underserved. This includes expanding our current garden space to include a season extending high tunnel and working with our Youth Education Outreach Office to develop demonstration programming to the local community, as well as creating policies to increase the distribution of fresh produce through our Lions Pantry and other campus outlets. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Marilyn Wells, and I'm Chancellor at Penn State Brandywine. And I'm joined with the co-chairs of our Sustainability Commission, Mark Boudreau and Julie Stanton. I'll share a few of the highlights of our work this past year. For a number of years, our campus has had a sustainability committee, and this year we elevated that to a Chancellor's Commission on Sustainability that includes faculty, staff, and students from across all areas of the campus: academic affairs, student affairs, IT, finance and business, enrollment management. And so that's giving increased focus and impact to this commission. A few of our highlights that I will share is sustainability is one of three campus-specific values that we've highlighted in our Penn State Brandywine strategic plan. And while our campus in the past has focused on sustainability broadly, it has had a focus on climate. And so we focus on the planet, but also on the people and prosperity or economic justice. UN sustainable development goals that we focused on are 2, zero hunger, 5, gender equality, 10, reduced inequalities, and 10, peace, justice, and strong institutions. A few of the things that we're doing in each of the areas in planet, we're planning a carbon footprint assessment of our campus operations and practices and expand curricular focus and value of our campus garden. I've already spoken to the Chancellor's Commission on sustainability, but we also launched Chancellor's Commissions on Equity by Design. And again, those include matters such as gender, race, and other areas of equity. We launched and are growing our campus food pantry this fall, even with the pandemic, and have identified or developed a contactless way that students can request and garner food. We are also trying to elevate our fair trade designation and programs. Media, Pennsylvania, which is our address, was the first town in America designated as a fair trade town. And our campus has had that designation since about 2013. And we're trying to revitalize and reinvigorate and redesign that. All of this work has been supported by curricular initiatives and other areas with the involvement of student government. Thank you.
Good afternoon, I'm Chad Long. I'm the Director of Student Affairs at Penn State Fayette, the Everly campus. On behalf of our Chancellor and Chief Academic Officer, Dr. Charles Patrick, thank you for letting us be a part of this initiative today. And thank you to Paul and the entire Sustainability Institute for all of your efforts. As you'll see on the slide, we incorporated 3 ways that we're incorporating sustainability into our strategic plan. The first is creating a sustainability council. I'm honored to be the first chair of our sustainability council as we move forward. And we're hoping to bring all of our stakeholders together on campus and benchmark a lot of what you all have been doing in your sustainability councils. I'm gonna skip down to the last one there, and increasing educational activities on campus. We're really excited about helping students become healthier and improving their wellness on campus. But what we're most proud of is increasing students' knowledge of food systems. One of the things that we have done over the past year is created a campus garden. And we're helping students to realize what it takes to grow and plant and harvest in a garden. And the 3 main goals is to help students eat healthier, save money and tackle food insecurities, and connect students to cultural foodways and food systems. Through food insecurity, we've been able to tackle students' ability or inability to provide food and create a healthy and active lifestyle. So we've made connections with our food pantry and made connections with our campus nurse and our nutritionist to make sure that students are getting the food and nutrition that they need. We've also been able to connect students to nutrition programs and providing cooking classes. So now that we have the garden, students are harvesting the food. How do they prepare the food? So helping students create a healthy and delicious meal through preparation. And also each of us has a backstory, and food is one thing that brings all of our cultures together. And so we learn about each other and we learn about each other's cultures through food and through gardening. And so through our garden, we've been able to provide over 40 vegetables from 5 different countries and tying that into our international food showcase. So that's something we're really proud of doing and growing over the next several years. Thank you.
All right, good afternoon. I'm Rick Ciosi. I'm here representing Dr. Mason and the sustainability effort of Penn State Harrisburg. I chose 3 items that are current as what we're working on, but there's a lot more. We have the effort to move the sustainability leadership minor onto campus. We're working on course development in a couple of different areas. We expect our council to be formalized very soon, and we'll be putting out the charter hopefully by the end of this calendar year. The items that I chose to mention here, the Smart Home Research Initiative is a plan, something we're working with Masonic Village in Elizabethtown. The idea to design smart homes. If you're not familiar, Masonic Village is a very large retirement community that does have constant care for the people who need it, but they're also on the outskirts, little small homes. And the idea is that we can go after aging in place as an option for people if we can provide the right materials. So from a sustainability standpoint, what we're trying to do is assess what the energy needs or the power needs are on some of those smaller homes, and then work on developing renewable energy sources for those homes. We've had quite a long time on campus, the Biofuels Lab, Central Pennsylvania Research and Teaching Lab. They've been involved in the bioenergy, sustainable bioenergy for a number of years. But what's new is they're doing a little bit of work now with flax and industrial hemp, looking to see what can be gained from using those materials along with the other natural ones that they've been studying for some time. There is some hope for hemp as being incorporated in a number of different products. And then the Pennsylvania Recycling Market Center, I've mentioned them once or twice before in front of some of the people in this group. It's Department of Energy, Department of Environmental Protection funded, but they're on campus with us and we're looking at partnerships with them.
Hi, everybody. I'm Gene Grogan. I'm the Director of Business Services here at the Penn State Scranton campus. I just wanted to touch base on a few things that we've been doing. One of the main things that we're kind of proud of is that with our redoing our strategic plan, we're able to get into our goal number one, promoting sustainability through the environment, employee, and the economic well-being. So we're pretty proud that that's actually right in our strategic plan now and up on goal number one. One of the things that we've also been doing for many years now, our campus is 50 plus years old. It's the building's very outdated, electric heat throughout all the buildings. So we've been upgrading our systems over the past couple of years, spending hundreds of thousands of dollars upgrading our systems to become more energy efficient. We're continuing that. We're finishing up a new building we just purchased for our mechanical engineering. We converted a warehouse, an old warehouse into our engineering building, which should be open for the fall of 2021. And lastly, the campus has been working closely with our ag extension this past year. We're hopefully after COVID ends, we're gonna be able to start doing some things that we've been talking about. And some of these are actually coming from our students that serve on our committee. We're going to create a pollinating garden. Hopefully we're going to be able to put a greenhouse on the campus. Obviously that'll have to go through campus planning and design. And the hope is that from that greenhouse, we can start a community garden. We have some student housing, it's privately owned next to the campus that opened up a few years ago. And that's where we see a lot of our students that are have the food insecurities. So our hope is that some of them, when they are here on campus, they'll partake in that garden and help maintain it. And lastly, we're looking at some alternative landscaping to really eliminate some invasive species that have been kind of encroaching on our property, especially around our athletic fields. So that's what we hope to be doing this coming year. Thank you.
Hi, we represent Penn State Wilkes-Barre. I am Sean McHale, Director of Business Services, and joined by Aaron Brennan, Assistant Teaching Professor of Business. We're the co-chairs of the newly formed Sustainability Council, which aims to educate our campus and surrounding community on sustainability in furtherance of the sustainability goal that is advanced in our campus strategic plan with the support of Dr. Dale Jones, our campus CAO and chancellor. In addition to this year's new governance structures, the strategic plan, the Sustainability Council, and the student-led sustainability committee, we are focusing on academics and events leading to the environmental colloquium in April. On the academic end, we have incorporated a special topic in sustainability course offering, and have also added sustainability curriculum in our first year seminar. We have surveyed courses to link outcomes to the sustainability development goals, and we have asked faculty to include SDG badges for their goals in their syllabi where appropriate. Our overall aim is to have comprehensive campus and community involvement in and awareness of sustainability. Part of that will be our spring 2021 campus events, which include a collaboration with Penn State Beaver on a Theater of War event, as well as campus-wide events leading to the Environmental Colloquium livestream. We wanted to share these three highlights from the 2021 academic year. Thank you.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for being here and holding on this long. I'm Megan Hoskins, Director of Operations and Partnerships at the Sustainability Institute, and I'm the current chair of the Sustainable Operations Council. I also see that our executive team is on the call, so thank you to Paul, Bill Sitsiby, John Papazoglou, and new to the university, Sarah Thorndike. Thank you for being here. As an introduction to the council, we were chartered by the finance and business leadership to support the strategic engagement of sustainability in all facets of the operations of the university. Our membership is shown on the right side of the slide. We consist of members from units across university operations, as well as a faculty senate member, a student member from the University Park Undergraduate Association, and an SI affiliate member. Our goals are to collaborate and support each other across units that don't necessarily work together regularly, to increase the sustainability of our operations, and to look for opportunities to involve students in any of our work. I've listed a few of our initiatives on the slide here that have been moving forward in spite of, and sometimes in because of, the pandemic that turned a lot of the operations upside down in the past year. We also have a few new initiatives starting up that we hope to highlight at next year's spotlight. As a council, we also look forward to being a part of the implementation of the strategy that's being put into the Finance and Business Strategic Plan. I want to thank the Planning Committee that was led by Kurt Kissinger and Sue Cromwell for being open to input and for including all three facets of sustainability, environmental, social, and financial sustainability into the plan. The Sustainable Operations Council looks forward to supporting the efforts that will be needed to succeed in all of those areas. For more information about these and other initiatives, please check out the Sustainability Institute website, the Finance and Business website, or reach out directly to us. We're always happy to hear people's ideas. Thank you for your interest and engagement in sustainability here at Penn State.
Okay, thank you very much. Wow, that was amazing. All of these units of the university are diligently building sustainability across the university as part of their plans. Thank you to the presenters. You are all stars. And as Janet put it, you all have class. So you can see sustainability is now a pan-university activity happening in many units, covering many diverse things from food to water to the 17 sustainable development goals that are necessary for our collective flourishing. We aspire to integrate sustainability into all units of the university, so there's much more work to be done. All this work is made possible by the guidance and support of and reports back to our Executive Vice President and Provost, Dr. Nicholas Jones. He has been an enduring supporter of our work, for which I thank him, and now I invite him to offer his thoughts on the way forward towards a sustainable Penn State. Nick?
Great, thanks very much, Paul. I guess the first question I would have is how do you get 20 people to stick to 2 minutes each, or pretty close to it? That's a skill I haven't learned yet. And so I need to get some advice from you, Paul, about how to do that for the future. Paul asked me to react to and reflect upon the conversation that just took place. So I've been, while you were all talking, I was listening and scribbling notes here and trying to organize them. Clearly, the first thing that stands out as I listen to the 20 of you describe all of the activity that's going on is the scope and the diversity of the efforts. Paul just mentioned that, but I'll really call that out. It's really extraordinary just to see in how many different directions you have taken this charge, but also how it's all linked together with a commonality of mission and purpose. So it's really very extraordinary. There are conversations taking place that weren't taking place a few years ago. There are connections being forged both within units and across units that we didn't see happening. And perhaps most importantly, as was demonstrated today, there's action. There are things happening. There are things being done. There is food being produced at our student farm. I could go down the list of things that have been described. Pretty amazing. All of this didn't happen by accident, of course. Penn State, as was pointed out by the president in his remarks and touched on by some of you, Penn State has a longstanding commitment to sustainability and principles of sustainability. More recently, about eight years or so ago, we formed the Sustainability Institute, which played a critical and unique role. Not too long after that, we decided as an institution that it was important that we appoint a chief sustainability officer. And of course, Paul was hired both to be the CSO and the director of the SI to really firm up the university's commitment to not only talking the talk about sustainability, but actually walking the walk and walking the walk in our own backyard, making sure that we were truly focused on all of the things that we have been holding dear. Another critical piece of this, I think, and it's very exciting for me to see, is how a lot of this has come together under the umbrella of the strategic plan. Back in 2013-14, in the prior version of the current strategic plan, we identified sustainability as one of the foundational elements. I would say we made some progress in the first 5 years of the plan, but not enough. And I really give credit to Paul, obviously, and his team, but also to Au Pair and in particular Daniel Newhart for their really amazing efforts to ensure that all of the foundations were indeed threaded through all of the thematic priorities and were all connected to one another. And what we have seen over the course of the past couple of years is really just an explosion in activity with the formation of the councils and everybody coming together to talk about what they can be doing in their units a little bit more specifically. And perhaps most importantly now, as the final version of the plan comes together, how all of these efforts across the various units of the university can be connected. I think most of you are aware that back in November of 2019, after the fall of 2019, and a number of discussions among the Planning Oversight Committee, we did zero in on resiliency as a core theme for the next incarnation of the strategic plan, which will be going live within months. Of course, November 2019, we had no idea what February of 2020 would bring and with COVID. And I think we learned firsthand, one, how important resiliency is, and two, how it's another case of being easy to say the word, but a whole lot harder to actually live it. So I think we've all learned a lot over the course of the past 12 months about what resiliency really, really means and why it is important. So I come away from this conversation really excited about the opportunity that I feel that we have to unleash the collective strengths and passion that exists across the university. And I really commend all of you and thank Paul for his leadership in really getting this all fired up and to see the great work that is taking place. The way that these are all connected to one another through the themes and other foundations is amazing. And the opportunity for us as an institution in this space to really exceed the sum of our parts is truly exciting to behold. Of course, and you all know this, we can talk about this until the cows come home. Sorry, New Zealand expression. The key is going to be action. How do we take all of this good thinking and really translate it into tangible actions? How are we going to leverage all the great research that is being done across the institution? How are we going to leverage the power of our numbers? You know, the fact that we have 100,000 students, and if we can influence and engage them in sustainability activity, what the trickle-down effects of that is going to be as these students graduate and go out into the world. And how do we think about operationalizing many of the things that we're thinking about, again, in our own backyards? What are the things that we can be doing better as an institution? And certainly the effort and the task force that the president will be forming soon around our carbon goals is going to be critical to that. How can we take all of this good thinking and really change the way that we do business? We are Pennsylvania's land-grant university. Leading the way in the Commonwealth is has always been vital to our mission for 150 years or more. This is a really important responsibility that we now have as Pennsylvania's land-grant institution, and it's our opportunity to really seize this and take it forward. So thank you for all of the great work that you have done. Paul, thanks for your leadership in pulling this all together. And I am just really excited to see how this is all going to play out as we move forward to implementing the strategic plan and look forward to making the investments that are necessary to pull this off. So thanks, and thanks for the opportunity to listen and to comment at the end.
Sorry, I forgot to unmute myself. Thank you, Provost Jones, and thank you, President Barron, for your remarks and for staying till the end and being patient with the 20 plus presentations over here. We are at 7 minutes past 5 o'clock, so we are about maybe 5 minutes over time, and I appreciate the patience of everybody. I just want to say this was a historic day, both for what has been happening in Washington, but also for what we see happening across Penn State in sustainability. It gives us reason for hope. I want to thank all the deans and chancellors who have made it possible for this to happen. We see the Sustainability Institute not as a prime actor, but as a facilitator, as a catalyst, as a consultant, if you will. The real work is getting done in colleges and campuses. I also want to thank the Sustainability Council chairs. And thank you, Provost Jones, for calling out Daniel Newhart's work in strategic planning, because he had a very open mind and invited us into the process to allow us to help the units to shape their strategic plans. So thank you all for attending. It's been a great evening, and hope you enjoy the rest of it. Goodbye.